before you talk about the history, you've got to know the prehistory. So I came out with the idea, the visual image, which begins with painting, and how from painting we led to photography. From photography, how we led to a series of still images which tackle the idea of motion and the people who were behind it and why they were looking at the idea of cinema. People looked at cinema basically as a scientific investigation of various sorts. And there was no other purpose by which cinema was developed. But thereafter, when I kept studying the people who were the pioneers of the filmmaking and when they went through, different ways of approaching came about. Even in terms of storytelling, different ideas were developed by different people. And you would see that the difference between the way an Edwin Porter would look at cinema as against the way a Pathé would look at cinema from France, or the way Georges Méliès took his ideas of cinema into a different realm altogether. Having looked at the storytelling film, I was also amazed that people like Porter would also look at another area of cinema. It also deals with non-fiction. It also deals with the idea of what is known as actuality. An actuality linked to, say, documentary or the capturing of an event or a situation or even a real life situation on the street. And in the process of looking at the different areas of, shall we call it as non-fiction, I discovered that there were a lot of people who were not necessarily filmmakers initially, but who were exploring different fields, who were writers, poets, artists, musicians. These people were looking at cinema as a new medium for themselves to explore their own ideas. An artist like Marcel Duchamp would slowly move from a certain type of work that he was doing to even making short films. And obviously the films that he would make would be a relationship to his own thinking, linked to the idea of motion to some extent. And then there were some very radical filmmakers, especially in France, who were developed the idea of a pure cinema, a cinema which is devoid of storytelling, which is basically a series of symbols or ideas which they have derived from the word, and therefore they created stories around that. So the French in the early stages did that a lot. There was a woman called Germaine Dulac, who was one of the early journalists of that period. And her stories reflect a lot of the issues around women. So it evolved from storytelling to making a comment on situations, or probably of the lives of the women around her. And it really amazed me that here it is on record, and we are living in India at a point of time when the issues of feminism have been discussed and being projected so much in the media today. And here was Germaine Dulac in the 1920s talking about those issues and recording them and putting them on a film, which are absolutely relevant today. And then, of course, there were the other filmmakers who abstracted films not from stories itself, not from the narrative itself, but who took certain concepts which were very personal to their own existence, and they projected stories like that. The Germans did it like that. There was this man called Walter Ruttmann, who took a lot of abstract images and almost animated figures or concepts along with color and created images around that. There was a man called Hans Richter, who had his own interpretation of films and eventually developed a huge theory of the avant-garde cinema. Now, the advantage that cinema had at that point of time was that the idea of sound, which had actually emerged before the image had developed on a movie camera, had still not been able to be picked up as to put it together. So while sound was developing and being presented through records and phonogram, on film it was not happening. So visual language actually had to develop totally on its own. And it is this language which developed for 25-30 years before sound actually made its beginning on film. That is an absolute eye-opener, which is why I have concentrated on that eye-opener, because that language which developed, which again got lost when sound started and again had to find its voice as it went along, was something which I felt people who have never been exposed to silent cinema should look at. And therefore, the idea and the obsession with how the visual can change, how the idea of a shot without any sound to it can give you a meaning which, and add it to another shot and another shot and another shot, can keep changing the meanings, both because of its graphic representation and because of its interaction. I thought these were absolutely amazing to learn, and which is the basic language which was developed. I decided on a principle that people from various backgrounds, not necessarily film backgrounds, people who are younger in age, who had a huge curiosity, they suggested I have a statement of purpose as to why you want to attend. Based on that, I was able to create a group of people which I sent out to them. There were people who were not only from Kochi, which was amazing, they were from different parts of Kerala, they were from different states beyond Kerala. And I even have presently a chap who's come all the way from Mumbai. So I think it's a great beginning of something which Kochi Biennale has looked at. I think the vision behind this sort of thing is really very useful to people like me, who can then take the project forward.